It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Great moments are born from great opportunity. And that's what you have here. That's what you've earned here tonight.
Forget about the crowd, the size of the school, their fancy uniforms. And remember what got you here. If you put your effort and concentration into playing to your potential, to be the best that you can be, I don't care what the scoreboard says, at the end of the game, in my book, we're going to be winners.
On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. We claw with our fingernails for that inch because we know when we add up all those inches, that's going to make the f***ing difference between winning and losing.
It's Down to the Wire with Errol Marks and Speedy Petey.
Oh, Petey.
On the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Down to the Wire. I'm your host, Errol Marks. My co-host, Mr. Vibrating Speedy Petey. How are you, Speeds?
I'm all right, but wish that comment didn't come out.
Why didn't that comment come out? Why shouldn't that comment come out?
Because you've over-exaggerated
everything. I have not over-exaggerated anything.
Yeah. You've gone every show, the last five shows, saying that word.
What, vibrating?
Mm-hmm.
What, you don't like the new vibrators we got for you?
No, I don't. For one thing, because I know they don't exist.
They do exist. I'm telling you they exist. And I'm going to show everybody one very, very soon. It is perfect for the sales and introduction of Speedy Petey's new vibration. Anyways, as you guys know, you can call us at 631-965-4990 or the 631-971-9080, if I'm not mistaken, right? Or 8070. I'm sorry. 8070. I got it. I got you. 971-8070 is the other number. As you guys know, you can follow us on all the social medias. How do you do that? You go to our website at www.worldwidesportsradio.com and search us on all the social medias. You go to Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, you name it. We're on it. Radio.com. As you guys know, we're on iHeartRadio. We're on TuneIn Radio. So definitely search us throughout the social media market. And if you don't want to look at me, you can cross me out and just look at this beautiful schnoz of a man right over here. So Speedy Petey, as you guys know, the great one, the greatest statistician who just doesn't shut up. So that's why we call him Speedy Petey. Anyways, before we get into what we really want to get into today in sports, I want to say this. And all this corona situation, and I understand a lot of people are not taking this seriously. And I'm one of those guys and one of those people over the last couple of weeks that, not that I haven't taken this seriously, I just look at the flu and how many people die from the flu every single year, and nobody really has treated the flu like this. And I understand they think they have a cure for the flu. They don't. They have a serum that slows down the flu or helps you keep the flu out of your system. Or if it does come into your system, it tallies away quicker, or it doesn't come in. You don't get it worse than most people do. And now they're trying to find something. And there's a lot of people dying from this coronavirus situation, this epidemic. And everybody is thinking that the world is going to end. Here on Long Island, there's a bunch of gun shops and you name it, dollar stores. You can't even get toilet paper in dollar stores.
Oh.
You can't get toilet paper and you can't get Scott Dowels. So if you want to make chicken cutlets or something like that, good luck trying to find yourself some Scott Dowels, because some woman named Molly has them in her basement packed out from the brim because she thinks the world's going to end.
100 towels being held hostage and probably will be never used again.
I mean, it's ridiculous. You go into a food market, and I've gone to plenty of them, Meat Farms, ShopRite, Stop and Shop, you name it. I've been in practically all of them, including every single dollar store. And when I tell you you really can't find toilet paper, the best time to find toilet paper is at 7-Eleven at midnight. Mm-hmm. That is the best time to find toilet paper. So if you guys are looking for toilet paper here in Long Island or New York, go to 7-Eleven when their new batch is out there on the rack at 12 o'clock in the morning. So there you go, Speedy. And you're up all hours of the night, so you can jet down there for your grandparents and make sure you have something to wipe your ass with. What do you think? Well, it's not good, guys. You know, it's better than using your hand, that's for sure. Anyways.
Which I don't do, but okay.
Well, we don't know that. Anyways, I do want to get into this topic that I don't necessarily hear anybody talk about. And right now, since sports is not going on because of the coronavirus, you're trying to find stories that you would get into that people would argue at a bar. And this particular story, I was sitting here with Speedy and I said, do you realize that the business of sports has changed really the competition of really, you look at these superstars now on these different teams. In the 80s and the 70s, the Oakland Raiders hated the Bears, and the Bears hated the Oakland Raiders. And whenever they played, no matter how many people you thought liked each other, they were out there to kill each other. It wasn't about the money. It was about the
vengeance of the rivalries.
The vengeance, the fame, and really putting your name out there as a Hall of Famer. Now it's not even about the Hall of Fame. It's about what endorsements you're going to get, what brands you're going to work with going forward as a professional athlete. Are you going to work with Reebok, Nike, Adidas, Puma, whatever organization you want to work with that's going to give you a product that you're going to be able to sell and make money off of? And if you look at the contracts that some of these players are getting now, it's outrageous. You got Chris Paul right now entering his what? His 14th or 15th, maybe even longer than that.
I think it's his 15th season.
15th yeah. NBA season. And this guy's making $42 million a year. $42 million a year. When you look at Patrick Ewing, how about this? Michael Jordan. The most Michael Jordan ever made in a year, I think it was like $20 million, $19 million.
Well, Michael Jordan also makes like $5 million a day, or maybe even more with his Air Jordan.
No, he doesn't make $5 million a day. He has a contract with Nike where he makes $45 to $50 million a year.
Okay.
A year for the rest of his life.
All right, well,
that's a lot of money. Still.
He might accumulate that off whatever
could you
percentage
imagine
that,
making, that
he gets with the shoes.
Imagine
though,
making
too.
$50 million a year for the rest of your life from Nike, and you don't really have to do anything.
Nope.
You don't have to do anything. You own the Charlotte Hornets. You own all these different golf courses, and you sit back and you look at Michael Jordan. Billionaire is not even the word. I mean, this guy is an all-time great, if not the greatest athlete to ever play the sport in the sports world here in the United States and throughout the world in my eyes. But you look at business in sports, it's taken over really the competitive fashion of what sports really should be. These guys are now all about getting that extension, that money, that big contract, that they're going to get their $160, $170 million. I'm talking about baseball players. And then they don't have to play anymore. They get their contract, like Jacoby Ellsbury from the New York Yankees, and he decides, I don't need to play anymore. I got that contract. That contract is guaranteed. I don't have to play good anymore. And football players, who I think is the biggest, you know, the biggest joke in professional sports, because nothing is guaranteed but the signing bonus that they get. These players, they have to play well year in and year out, or they're screwed.
Yeah, they don't get the longest deals in terms of the length, like baseball and even hockey players get 8-year deals. Football players, you'd be lucky if you get a 5-year deal. You have to be that good.
But you have to look at football. Football players, they really don't like each other. If they're playing for an organization that doesn't like another organization, like Pittsburgh and the Browns, as two organizations.
The Browns. Yeah. That would be the example to use. How about the Bengals?
Bengals or even the...
the Steelers and Bengals have hated each other for years. Yeah,
or the Baltimore Ravens. But I'm just saying, these teams, they used to hate each other, and they still hate each other. Only in football do these teams still, these players, when they go to these organizations, hate those other organizations, even if your best friend is playing for that organization.
The Bengals-Steelers 2015 playoff game is not a great indicator of that.
It's not like it used to be in hockey or basketball or even baseball, how much the Red Sox hated the Yankees. And even when you heard the whole Aaron Judge, when he passed and he was playing New York, New York, passing the Red Sox locker room. And I know everybody's going to sit here and tell me, well, the Red Sox still don't like the Yankees. Meanwhile, over the years, Robinson Cano was so close with David Ortiz and Pedro Martinez. I mean, these teams, these players, they love each other now. It's not about arch enemies or arch organizations hating each other. It really isn't like that in professional sports. It's pay me, what am I making off this deal? Even these kids buying jerseys. They're not buying the jerseys because they love the team. They're buying the jerseys because they love the player. How many times do you walk around, you look at a Golden State Warrior jersey that people are wearing, the Steph Curry, the number, and you look at Steph Curry and you're just like, are you really a Golden State Warrior fan or are you just a Steph Curry? Oh, I'm a Golden State Warrior fan. Yeah, sure you are.
Yeah, name five other players on the team.
When I went to Miller's Ale House one night for the NBA Finals, and I walked into Miller's Ale House, and you know this is a New York area. This is not an L.A. area or a Golden State area or a San Francisco area. The real fake sports fan comes out. They really do. Not only was Miller's Ale House packed, it was packed with Golden State Warrior fans, with Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, and Mark Jackson jerseys. Mm-hmm. Walking around Miller's Ale House. I'm talking about, there was about 1,000 people there. You couldn't even find a seat because the Golden State Warriors were in there. There are so many Golden State fake Warrior fans here in New York. It's ridiculous. And it's not because, and I'm not blaming the NBA because they know how to sell a product and they know how to sell the player. I yell at the NBA because they forgot the competitive nature that the NBA should be. Even LeBron James, you kidding me?
Tons of them.
LeBron James, when he loses a championship, he knows he's going to go back the next year with another team. And so what does he have to worry about?
And his fans are going to follow him wherever he goes.
Exactly, a.k.a. Mike Guido. I guarantee you Mike Guido is not, as much as he says he's a Cleveland Cavs fan, he's not a Cleveland Cavs fan right now.
No.
I beg to differ on it. He was a Cleveland Cavs fan because of LeBron James. And that's the problem with professional sports. It's become a business. It's not about, you know, when I was a kid and I was a New York Knicks fan, I hated the Bulls. I hated Michael Jordan. I hated Scottie Pippen. And I didn't even want to hear the name Horace Grant out there in the 90s. I never even want to listen to it. Dennis Rodman, when he went to in 1995, when he went to the Bulls, and then Michael Jordan came back in 95-96, I knew how good that team was going to be, and I hated them because I was a Knicks fan. And when Michael Jordan was finally retired for 2 years, I thought it was the Knicks' opportunity to win a championship, and then they go against the Rockets in 94, and they get their butts whipped when they were up 3-2.
They're up 3-2, yeah. They got blown out in that game 7 too, right?
And they, yes.
Yeah.
And they hated each other. And that's because John Starks hit like 17, 18 brick 3-point shots. Mm-hmm. And Charles Smith can't put up a layup. I mean, I'm telling you. And I still hate the Chicago Bulls to this day. And they're not even, they're lifeless. They don't have Michael Jordan.
Yeah, they haven't been relevant since Derrick Rose and Jimmy Butler were together probably in, what, 13, 14? Yeah.
I still can't stand that organization because I grew up to hate them. These kids don't know what it is to hate a team, an organization. They were, over the years in the 80s, why did they call the Yankees the Evil Empire in the 80s going into the 90s to the new era? They called them the Evil Empire because they always won. Then you talk about the Red Sox, how they've dominated the last 15 years. What are you going to call them? Or the Giants? I mean, this is, and you look at the fans now, these kids, these millennials, I don't think they really follow the sports as much as maybe the old timers do, or the 40s and 50 and 60 year olds.
No, they definitely don't. They're definitely more player oriented.
It's all about fantasy.
Especially with basketball, it's really with the players. Baseball too, to an extent, they just like the players. They like, again, getting autographs, getting their jerseys, just that's what they like now. They don't really follow us closely with the teams. My youngest brother's great.
Who cares about your younger brother?
My youngest brother's great. I know some of his friends. They were definitely like that, where they didn't really know the team well. They just knew certain players. Like, they didn't follow it like I did when he was when I was his age.
But this ruins sports.
It does. It does.
It does, because I'm sorry. I understand there are front runners out there. I understand. Mikey C is a front runner. I say this all the time. If you guys know Mikey C, he is a Boston Celtic fan because of Larry Bird. Because of Larry Bird. Because he loved the great three-point white guy that would go into the corner and hit the big shot in the games in the 80s. And he wanted to find somebody to follow, and that was Larry Bird. I mean, how many people? I'll say I was a front runner when it came to hockey because I was a John Van Beesbrouck fan.
But that was your player, though.
That was my player, yes.
You didn't watch him because they were in the finals all the time and because he was on a loaded team. You watched him because he was your icon of a hockey player.
A hockey player, yes. But I still followed. Eventually, I became an Islander fan, and I stuck with the Islanders. But these kids, and I understand it's a business. I understand the game is now, it's all about fantasy. It's all about betting. We all know this, and it's changed everything in professional sports. Betting is going to change everything. When it becomes legalized here in New York, you see what it's doing in New Jersey, and a lot of New Yorkers are going over the cross island or whatever the heck you have to go, the George Washington, to get into New Jersey just to make bets. And then they come right back to New York. Over 60% of the bets from New Jersey are New Yorkers. And I think the business of the game has changed. It's transitioned the game. And now the players, to me, are not playing as hard to win those titles. It's not a big deal to win those championships like we've seen over the years. Like I said, the Baltimore Ravens or the New York Giants, when they get into the playoffs and what they needed to do to go through the Bears or go against the Eagles or something like that.
No, don't remind me of the Eagles. Ugh, those playoff games were heartbreaking.
I mean, seriously. But these kids, they don't care about the playoffs because if it's Odell Beckham, like here in New York, when Odell Beckham was the only real big superstar on the team, everybody loved Odell Beckham. Then all of a sudden he started opening his mouth and doing stupid things. The old-timers opened their mouths. And they wanted Odell Beckham out, and eventually, Mara gave them their wish. Now, I understand that. To me, that was the smart move when it comes to business. But was it?
I don't know. Too early to tell, but probably not.
I mean, to me, the way the business of the game has transitioned, it's ruined the game, the competitive fashion of the game. You have players that want to go and play with their friends now in the NBA to win titles. Meanwhile, you would never see Larry Bird and Magic Johnson band together to go and dominate the league. You would never see that. Or Michael Jordan and Magic Johnson. Or Michael Jordan and Shaquille O'Neal. You would never see that.
Now, do you think that's only a basketball issue, though?
No, it's baseball, too.
Because baseball still had some level of competitive balance where they still have, like, maybe second-tier markets.
How many good
and mid-markets.
Teams? How many good teams are there in professional baseball? Seriously.
How many good teams?
How many good, really good teams are in professional baseball right now?
There's a difference between good and really good.
No. Just tell me good teams. Give me the amount of good teams that are in baseball right now that are going to compete for a championship every year.
Okay. I would say the Dodgers, the Yankees, the Braves. I would say
the Braves just became one, so you can't really put them.
Yeah, but they've been a playoff team the last two years, and they have one of the best farm systems. I would say the Twins are up there now. They had a very good offseason.
They're never going to win. Go ahead.
Well, if they play the Yankees, no, but they're up there. I would say the Cardinals are up there right now. I would say, let's see, the Phillies and the Phillies.
All right, so let's just say about seven or eight teams, really good teams, they have a chance to win every single year. How many teams are there in the major leagues?
30.
There are 30 teams. That means that more than half, you could put them through, go ahead. More than half of the teams in the major leagues, more than half of the teams in the major leagues are suffering. They have no chance of making it to the playoffs or going anywhere. Hold on one second, Anthony. Hold on one second. But to me, when you look at professional sports and the transition of the game, the business part of the game, it's ruining the game. Not for the millennials, but for the fans that, well, I'm sorry, not for the older fans, but for the millennials. Because the millennials don't understand what it's like to be a fan of a team. A team growing up and being only a fan of one team. All right, put Anthony through. Anthony, what's going on, my friend?
What's going on, buddy? Well, you know, I heard gambling. When you said 60% of the bettors are in New York,
yes,
I figured, you know, I'm probably the 60% right there. But, no, when you were talking about specifically how the game's changed and it seems like players don't play as hard and everything, there is one thing that I've always said when I say I miss basketball 80s and 90s, or I miss football. Football was more fun in the 80s and such. I think nowadays when a lot of these professional leagues expanding the playoffs to more teams, I don't think it gives the players so much of a sense of urgency. Specifically, like, for instance, football now. You know, you guys probably remember when football was three divisions.
Yeah, that was before my time, but Arrow probably was watching, man.
Yep.
I mean, I don't know how. I mean, then again, I'm probably saying that was what, 25 years ago?
That was up until 1996 when the Jaguars and the Ravens and Panthers came in.
Yes.
That was up until that for a while. Then the current setup came in with the Texans in 02.
Right. So I think sometimes with this sense of urgency, you know, when it comes to players, it's like, oh, well, we'll make a wild card. It's similar to that idea of, well, we're just trying to get in, and then everything goes to zero. Well, you know, I think it kills a little bit of the work ethic, and I think it kills some of the urgency to win. And I mean, that's in football. Now when it comes to basketball, you know, basketball, the eight teams, now they're talking about changing, and Speedy probably knows the exact of this based off of what the commissioner was saying. In a year or two from now, isn't it going to be all just East and West? I think
they were proposing it. I don't think they actually accepted it, though. It was just an idea. I think what they were doing is they were going to do a top 16, and they're going to have it, and they were going to have it, and they were going to have it where it was mixed like that. And they were also thinking of doing 10 teams per conference with a 7-10 playing and an 8-9 playing in a one game playoff, like they do for baseball,
which
I think is too much.
But that's not my argument here. My argument isn't the way the game has changed when it comes to the rules. We've spoken about that, and I believe that the rules is only going to make the games worse in the long run. But the business
quarterbacks anymore.
Yeah, but
when you used to have sacks,
yeah.
Soon they're going to take away sacks.
Well, that's not even that. It's not. That's not even my argument. It's these players are making so much money, they're not even playing hard anymore. Once they get that big contract, they don't give a crap about where they're going as a team or as an organization. Look at what Muhammad Wilkerson did to the New York Jets. He got an $86 million contract. He went to a Pro Bowl. He had, I think, 12 or 13 sacks that year. It was his best year.
Right.
And then he decided to, you know, he was waiting for the Jets to give him the contract.
Right.
He cashed in. The Jets gave him $38 million guaranteed. I remember it. $86 million. Mm-hmm. The guy never played another big game for the New York Jets again. He was there for almost three years, and the Jets had to move on from him. He went to Green Bay, and he got hurt that last year. And he hasn't been the same player since he broke his labrum.
That's a common trend even just this decade as a whole. Not only in football, but in baseball, too. They usually struggle that first year just because they get a little more relaxed, whereas the previous year, they're trying to play for the contract, so they're playing with a lot more urgency. Now, sometimes that can lead to pressure, and obviously, then they wouldn't get paid as much, but usually that leads to having the big year that year and then regressing.
And if you ever noticed, sometimes the way they just portray it in regards to the player, that's why when you say the game is played a certain way now, the mentality is different with players. The players just themselves, the makeup of a player, is different in regards to what do they play for, what's their motivation and such. If you watch it from this standpoint, one of the best, I guess, models to watch, to use as a model or like a little bit of like, I guess you could say a case study, if you ever watch Hard Knocks.
Of course.
And you basically see, but a lot of people see it as, oh, this is so funny, it's so entertaining. Exactly. These guys are actually working right now.
Mm-hmm.
But because the damn camera's around, whatever they would have did when the camera's not around is basically just crumpled up like a piece of newspaper and thrown over the shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
And And really, it comes to the point of what you guys were talking about. Also, the generation of millennials.
Yes.
Whatever. I mean, I don't even know how far millennials goes.
Millennials are
part of it. Yes. I'm the beginning of it, kind of.
Speedy is a millennial. I look at the millennials from the age of 12 all the way to the age of about 29, 30. That's the new millennials. I think the age of 31, 32 and up all the way to the 50s, 55, they understand how radio is, how sports radio is. They understand that the aggressiveness of each and every other organization on what they're trying to do because they want to win championships. But as far as the fans are concerned, the new millennials, they're not, and even some of the GMs now that are coming in, they're millennial GMs or even the millennial coaches that you see, the Sean McVays and the Nagys.
Yeah, exactly.
Or the Nagys. These guys are right there to the millennials that you look at, the young coach that looks at the game completely different than us, the older, more understanding of where we still believe that defense wins championships. I think the NFL has been trying to change that. The NBA has tried to change that. The NHL has tried to change that. And it's ruining the game. Look at baseball. They're trying to bring in robotic umpires because they think the game will be faster and there'll be more aggressive swings and more home runs and more opportunity to see more offense. This is why baseball wants to change the game. They want to see the game for the better, but it's not helping the game. It's ruining the game. And these millennial fans that have ruining – really look at the players, not as the team, as the aspect. Well, I'm a fan of the LA Lakers because I grew up a Magic Johnson, Kobe Bryant, and Shaquille O'Neal fan. No, I'm a Laker fan right now because LeBron James is there. And that to me is a front runner. And there are people over the years like Mikey C, who is a Celtic fan because of Larry Bird. I bring up Mikey C because there are people in the olden days that went that way because he was just a fan of a player, so he became a Celtic fan. I also look at the game for the worst because you got guys like Steph Curry now in the game or Russell Westbrook or somebody, or Kyrie Irving that people love and they adore, and they love the player. They don't love the team that he plays for. If he goes to the Nets, they become a Net fan. That's not the way you are. That's not the way sports is, you know, when you've been brought up by your family, your grandparents. My grandfather was a Yankee fan. So, and they used to be called the Yankees. They were the Indianapolis Yankees. There was a football team called the Indianapolis Yankees. So my grandfather rooted for the Indianapolis Colts because they were the Yankees at one time in the olden days. So,
right.
You know, he looks at the old-fashioned style of game. He wasn't a Giant fan. He wasn't a Jet fan. He was an Indianapolis Colts fan because of the Yankees. So, and he understood the game, you know, the way you would expect, you know, your father or your family to teach you what it is to grow up to be a sports fan. And it's changed completely because these millennials, they look at statistics, they look at betting, and they look at their research of the reason why I'm a big fan of this guy because he's the biggest superstar in the league.
One thing that annoys me, too, is with the betting and with the fantasy, they'll root for it over rooting for their own team. And that's really contradicting to the sports world, too. You should root for your own team over your own fantasy player, even if that matters more. And there's people that do that, and a lot of people that are real football fans get driven nuts. Even if they do play fantasy, they would still root for their own team first.
And what's funny about it is, why I say, when looking back at when football, you know, in the 80s or whatever was more fun to watch and such in divisions, now you have teams where you'll have a 15-win team, a 14-win team. Do you remember back in the 80s, the days of like LT, you know, even maybe the days of like Steve Young a little bit later into the 90s and stuff? You didn't see that. You didn't see that stuff.
Well, it's also, you know, that's also a result of a lot of bad teams now, too, though.
The super team and, you know, I'm not sure if that has to do with the contracts.
Yes, I think no salary cap. There was no salary cap in those days.
I think it also has to do, Anthony, with there being a lot of bad teams now, teams that are trying to be all young all at once. They do the tanking in baseball. They'll trade everyone away and try to get young all at once. So they're really bad for a while. And in essence, whoever is in those divisions or in those conferences feed off those really bad teams, too. Whereas it was much more closer. Even when I started watching sports in 2004, 2005, it was even closer then to what it is now, probably starting maybe 2013 or so.
And being a Knicks fan, okay, being a Knicks fan, I know Errol will appreciate this one. When the hell did you ever see a Knicks team in history that was a dominant Knicks team, like they were when Ewing and Charles Oakley were there, Mason, you know, all that? Probably even earlier than that when you had guys like, you know, when Pitino was the head coach. If you remember, even earlier than that.
Yeah, Rick Pitino.
Pitino was a pretty successful, you know, the Knicks were pretty successful under Pitino in the playoffs and stuff.
Yes, he was. Yes, they were. You know,
he changed Detroit and stuff.
He changed the NBA game, Rick Pitino, with the New York Knicks and the way the game was transitioned from defense to offense. Rick Pitino was the one that really transitioned the game to really higher heights for the New York Knicks in their organization at the time that he did it. Yeah, he absolutely did. But his game was more built for the, you know, for the college rankings more than the NBA, and that's why Pitino never really was successful in the NBA.
Well, hopefully he didn't recruit the same way.
You don't see defensive teams no more, though. You don't. You know what I mean? That's why even when the Knicks were successful back in the day, you know what, they would win like 96-82, keeping the game low scoring and this and that. You would never see like 123 to, you know, 75. You don't see, it wasn't about, you know, going nuts. It was more or less stopping them from
even the great.
It's really only today. It's really only the small market teams that are great defensively.
Even the great Chicago Bulls teams. They didn't score 120, 130 points. They did it here and there, but they never always did. I think those teams average about 101, 100 points. That's what they average. They're not like the Golden State Warriors because the game. No.
Because
the game was completely transitioned in a way that has affected the game for the worse, not the better. So I think that I think a lot of the change of making it more of a business than making it a competitive nature that we've grown to love the sports world, it's become more of a game. It's not a game of business. It's not about the game and the competitive nature.
So, now my question is,
we got to go to break
about that. That's the last thing. Besides the NBA, which obviously had the Cavs-Warriors finals for four straight years, has it really impacted the competitive balance that much in comparison to where there were still more dynasties in older versions of sports? Because baseball really hasn't had many. They had the Giants win. All right, they won three titles in a short span. Hockey really hasn't. They never had a back-to-back champion long time.
The Penguins.
Besides the Penguins, but...
Yeah, but there are not many of those teams.
But even then, the Penguins had a drought before that, and then it's been pretty scattered since then. Football is outside of the
Patriots.
How many
back-to-back teams won a World Series in the last 20 years?
Again, not many. That's what I'm saying.
It's, one team.
Right. That's what I'm saying, where they had those kinds of things in the 70s, in the 60s, a lot more. So I don't know if it's necessarily... of the NBA really affected the competitive balance in terms of judging which teams get in.
Who was the last team to win back-to-back-to-back times in the NBA?
3 years in a row?
Yeah. Chicago, wasn't it? No. The Lakers. The Lakers won three championships in a row. It was the Lakers.
It was? Okay.
Yes.
I thought it was 3 in 5 years. All right.
Yes.
I thought it was Chicago, actually. It wasn't?
I thought it was the Lakers. I'm pretty sure it was the Lakers.
I thought the Lakers repeated, and then they lost one to Boston.
That's what I thought. Well, no. Yes. At the end of the decade, they did. I think he's referring to the early 2000s.
I'm talking about Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant.
I even thought that was 3 in 5 years.
Right. I'm pretty sure it was 3 in a row, if I'm not mistaken. But nevertheless, Anthony, why don't you call back?
Yeah, you're right. 2000, 2001, 2002.
Yeah.
Well, I know you guys got to go to a break. You got a lot of stuff. You got a whole bunch of people. I'm sure Jeff wants to call in eventually.
I'm sure.
I'm sure Mikey C's going to call in eventually. Mikey C's got to call in sooner or later.
Nah.
Especially after all.
I don't know. It's a rarity what he calls nowadays.
You know what I mean? You're giving him a lot of kudos right now. I'm waiting for him to call in. Mm. So I'll let you guys go, and I'll talk to you soon.
Later, bro. Anthony Angerosi, he does the Caged In MMA show with me. We will be back on Friday talking MMA for all the fans. We'll have some special guests for upcoming fights that'll probably won't be until August or September, the way the sporting world is going with coronavirus. So we'll see what happens. I call it Corona with a lime. Anyways, when we come back, we'll get into more stories that you probably don't hear right now in professional sports or on really a radio station, but we're going to get into some stories that we want to get into. We also will get into NFL free agency when we come back here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
I used to play the cover of this. I actually covered this song when I was a kid.
Oh, nice.
Smells Like Teen Spirit. How could you forget this song? A classic.
Arguably the most iconic song of the 90s.
One of the most iconic writers of all time. In Mr. Corbin. Cobain.
Cobain.
I'm sorry. I go back and forth with names. I'm very bad. Anyways. Nirvana. Smells Like Teen Spirit. As you guys know, you can call us at 631-965-4990. And remember, you can follow us by going to our website at www.worldwidesportsradio.com. Our app is definitely coming out, guys. So, all these months, and I've been pushing it and pushing it for the last, I would say, 4 or 5 months, it will be out in the next couple of weeks.
Devin, so. Apple.
Well, it's not even Apple. It's really just the coding and getting the app where all the functions work for us, where we can do all the things that we need for the older and the millennial fans out there, that they'll be interested in downloading the app and actually interacting with us throughout the app. That was one of the main reasons why it took a little bit more time in developing this app. But I think people will be really impressed when they get the chance to get on there and where they don't have to look for us anymore. I don't have to tell you to go on all the different social media platforms. You could just find us and watch us or listen to us and not have that problem saying, I can't find you guys. I can't find you. Well, it'll be easy. WWSRN in the App Store, download the app and pop it on, and you get to see Speedy Petey's mug for the next couple of years. Who knows?
My mug?
Your mug. Your mugshot. That big ass head.
All right. So according to him, I'm going to commit a crime in the next whatever years.
Well, with that big ass head, I don't think anybody would forget that head. Speedy Petey. The greatest analytic, instigating pain in the ass on a sports radio show in the world. So there you go. Anyways,
so from that logic, I have a likelihood I could be accused falsely too.
Well, I mean,
if I look like the conventional big head,
well, your schnoz really stands out on your face. It really does. Gives you that big schnoz. Well, you know, the vibrator to the schnozinator. You know what I mean? So. It would be
that is a good word. I'll give you credit for that one. Schnozinator.
Yeah,
like that.
You like the
vibrator. On the other hand, not so much.
Why?
Stick with schnozinator.
No.
That sounds good.
You went from the vibrator to the schnozinator right now, so it will change back to the vibrator later in the show.
No.
Anyways,
schnozinator.
The NBA, since this coronavirus has come out, they were the first to speak up in the sports world that they're going to suspend their game. Then it came, then baseball, then NHL, then football, that all these organizations then started following in behind after Adam Silver made the decision on suspending the rest of the season as of right now. And now you're hearing stories coming out from the NBA that because the coronavirus is here, whenever the coronavirus goes away and they're ready to start up the season again, that they're going to change the rules of the NBA playoffs in this year's quest for that basketball trophy because of the season and the length of the season that they have left going into the playoffs. And if you see the new rules or the new thoughts of what they want to make this year's playoff run be, is they want to find one place for all these teams to go and play, like the NCAA tournament, like the NCAA championship, the Final Four.
Mm-hmm. Each round has its own spot, but yeah.
And I don't think this, and I understand they're trying to protect from the coronavirus, but they're coming back when practically the coronavirus will be gone, where it won't be an infective virus where people can catch it instantly. But now the NBA is trying to transition, change the wheel of what the NBA, if you want to do that, play 5-game series. If that's what you want to do. You're hearing 3-game series. Best out of 3. You're hearing a championship where you're going to be playing in practically locations. They're not going to be in Madison Square Garden if the Knicks are playing. It's not going to be in Chicago if the Bulls are playing. I'm just giving names right now.
Right, and the other thing, too, is the reason that these seeds are determined this way, and obviously home court is determined this way, is part of it is being able to stay comfortable and not having to travel as much, too. Travel lag is part of any sport, and it's part of the challenge of being a road team. Now you're taking that all away, where every team's going to have the same level of travel because they're all in the same hotels. They're all, well, not in the same hotels, but they're all in the same general location, and that's going to take away. And obviously, it's going to take away home field advantage not having the fans anyway, but they still – teams that are lower should still have to travel if they need to the cities they're playing to and vice versa in each series. That's what really, I think, takes it away for me, no matter what the length is. Because, again, with the length – yeah, okay, they might have to shorten it anyway. Depends on when it starts. But basketball is not one of the sports either where you have to worry about weather conditions as much because it's not outdoors. And it's not like hockey where the ice could be an issue and could get slushy and stuff like that in an arena. Basketball, you could stretch out to the time where you could still play the length of time. It's just a matter of when they'll come back.
And I think that these rules, the transition of these new rules that they might implement going into the playoffs this year, just for this year – it really ruins the fact that there should be an NBA playoff. It really does. Because all these teams, just like the NCAA tournament, all those teams that work so hard all season long to get to the final, to get to the NCAA tournament, to have the opportunity to go to the Final Four, just have the opportunity.
Especially the small market teams.
And then they cancel the NCAA tournament because of this virus, which I understand. I understand what they're trying to do. They're trying to protect the younger players. But the younger players are probably the more reliable source that will survive the coronavirus, because this virus really kills the younger and the older person that has viruses of their own, or they have deficiencies as far as kidney problems or cancer, whatever the heck they have. That's, to me, and I understand what the NBA is trying to do here, but changing the rules, then don't have the rest of the season. Don't have a playoff. Cancel this season, because you're never going to look at a team, if a team wins a championship, you're never going to look at that team as they were the true champions of that year, because they didn't earn it. That's the way I look at it. Professional sports should be earned. You should earn the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. And again, especially for the lower seeds of what would be, you're not going to have the same travel struggles that you would normally, especially in the NBA, where you don't see those kinds of upsets normally. Sometimes, obviously, with the NHL playoffs with the eight teams, you could see that, but not in the NBA. And usually, those road teams have to travel a lot, and it's going to take that away. It's going to be a big advantage to the 5-8 seeds that normally wouldn't have to do that. Now, obviously, depending on where it's located, there could be somewhat of a fan, not a fan advantage, but a location advantage where they wouldn't have to travel as much. If it's one of the locations that was brought up is in Las Vegas, which in an NBA final circumstance could be an advantage to the Western Conference team, depending on who makes the finals. But in terms of just an overall judgment of the seeding, it's not going to make as big of a difference. It's going to be an advantage to a team that would normally have to travel on the road for those longer trips, especially the 5, 6, and 7 games where they have to travel constantly.
It changes the game, the ethic of where basketball is and where it's changing into. I understand this has a lot to do with the virus situation, and I understand the NBA is trying to be an organization that's the lead organization out of all these organizations, where they're going, all these other organizations like the NFL, like the NHL, like the MLB, they're going to follow every single thing Adam Silver does, because a lot of people believe he is the only guy that has brains as a commissioner in professional sports.
But I don't think it's really that hard to have individual travel if they're concerned about maybe the players getting too close, or the players getting too close with people working with the airports or anything like that. I think there's ways for these players, especially NBA, and tons of rich contracts, to have individual travel where they can still deal with that, and then they can stay in their own hotel rooms in that particular city or outside that city in the suburbs. They have enough money for that. I don't see why they have to take away the travel aspect. And even though it's not a big home crowd, at least the home city advantage that teams like the Lakers, teams like Milwaukee in the East would get normally in this circumstance.
It's just a good argument. And again, the NBA is going to try to find any possible way to make sure that this playoff run exists, and it's going to happen this year. I think I could see more of the NHL canceling the season just because of the way the game is played and how the speed of the game and the the opportunity to sit back and wait until next year to go make another run for Lord Stanley's Cup. I know it would be the first time that an NHL team would not win a Stanley Cup in almost 100 years. I can understand that. But I also look at the way the game has changed in the NHL and the way the game is really implemented in the NBA and the NFL are completely different. And that's why I think baseball will still find a way to have at least 130, 140 games. Mm-hmm. Because I think that's just the way baseball is. They want to implement as many games because the more games there are, the more money the organization makes and the league makes as a whole. And that's why the NBA is bringing back. They'll definitely have a playoff run, even though they might change the rules and the thoughts of how it's going to be run just because of this year and the coronavirus. I just think if you're going to have a playoff, have a five-game series and do it the same way you do it every single year. If you're going to make this into a wishy-washy way where you're trying to sell something that doesn't exist in a way that you're putting it on a platform that is already a big platform, and it's the number two sport in all the professional sports here in the United States, you're going to ruin ruin the numbers for this year's playoff run and also hurt the thought that the growth of the sport because of the whole coronavirus.
Well, I don't know if it would ruin the numbers just because I think
– It would.
But just because I think in terms of the desperation of people to watch sports, they would just want to watch it just to watch it, even if you know what's going to happen, like the Lakers against whatever 8 seed they would play. People would watch just to watch because they're desperate to watch sports.
If it's a 3-game series with the Lakers have a chance to lose. If it's a 3-game series, all you got to lose is 2 games.
So why would that make the numbers worse then is what I'm saying.
Here's why it is. If you're a Lakers fan, you don't want to see your Lakers team be knocked out by an 8 seed because there's only 3 games in that run. So,
but I don't think that would stop them from watching, though.
I don't know if it's going to stop it. Speedy, you're misunderstanding.
Well, that's how the numbers are judged with the TV ratings.
Well, again, it's going to hurt TV ratings because you're not going to play as many games. So you're only playing 3 games when you can play 7 games in a series and absolutely completely take over the ratings in all of professional sports. You're cutting the games down and you're hurting the system for what it's been implemented for almost 100 years.
Right, but between the desperation for people now to watch sports and also the importance of each game, I don't think it would necessarily downgrade the ratings, especially with the NBA playoffs, the way they're structured. A lot of the first round.
It can because you're only playing 3 games to 7 games that you can make.
But
more
depending
money
on the series, a lot of those first round series are blowouts anyway. Not all the time. Sometimes the 3-6 ones are good and the 4-5 ones are good. But the Lakers are going to be a lot better than whoever's below 500 as the 8 seed, most likely. And in the East, that definitely. You're going to probably have a 37-38 win team, probably the Nets or the Magic or something like that would have been the 8 seed if they played out the season. That would take away from that, where a lot of those games are right.
Once it would be
3-0, those games would be like, all right, yeah, we know what's going to happen anyway. Let's just move on to the next series, where that would take it away. Fans watch for importance, and fans watch, again, for the desperation of just having sports in. So I don't think it would impact the ratings as much. Maybe long-term it could, but I don't think short-term it definitely would, just because we're so desperate to watch sports right now.
Right now. But when the playoffs and when everything comes back, I don't know how desperate we're going to be, because there'll be like 1, 2, 3, 4 sports going on at the same time. So we're not going to be desperate anymore. We're going to have a lot more to watch, knowing that because all the sports are coming back all at the same time. So.
But again, the NBA playoffs have still had that problem, though, with the early rounds because they're not as competitive. It's you know what's going to happen a lot of the time. You don't see a lot of 8-1 upsets and 7-2 upsets like you do in hockey or even like you do in the NCAA tournament where you have those first-round upsets. We saw 2 years ago a 16-1 upset. So you don't have that as much in the NBA, so they could flourish at least with that. And then when they're more top series coming through later on in the second round in the conference finals and stuff like that, people will still be watching like that, like regularly.
631-965-4990. The other number to call the show is 631-971-8070 is the number to call. As you know, this is Down to the Wire. We are live every single Monday and Tuesdays from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So if you guys want to listen to a great sports radio show, you can definitely check us out by going to our website at worldwidesportsradio.com. And by the way, guys, our app will be out in a couple of weeks. So you'll have the opportunity to download the app now and follow us and watch us on everything that we're doing as far as writing, our live streams, our live audios when you're driving home instead of watching us and getting yourself into an accident. You're going to be able to interact with us and win sweepstakes and prizes that we're going to have on our website and our app. So definitely check that out. Our app will be up on the iOS store and the Android store very, very soon. Very excited about that. When we come back, we're going to get into some NFL conversation and really free agency, the transition of what's going on in the NFL, the Jets, the Giants, the Buffalo Bills. You know it. We talk about it here on Down to the Wire. We'll be back after this.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Yes, Creed, Higher, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, I did play the drums. Yes, I did. When I was a kid, I played 10 years, almost 10 years of drums. So, yes, I was pretty damn good, too, Speed.
Nice.
If I had drumsticks right next to me right now, I'd beat you on the head with them.
And they wouldn't make good music.
How do you know?
Because I've been whacked on the head before.
With a drumstick?
Not with a drumstick.
Well, how do you know it won't make a bang-bang sound?
No, I don't think it would.
Try, guys.
Oh, God.
Anyways, 631-965-4990 is the number. And we should. And stop always there. Can you reach me higher? Right between your legs.
Oh, God.
You like that?
I knew you were going to do something weird.
You like that, Speedy?
Not between my legs. Not between my legs. You can put that offer out to someone else.
Right between my legs. Right?
Your legs? I mean, you could do whatever you want with those. I'm not going to judge.
Oh, man. Yes. Yes. I do want to give you a shout out. Give me the whole information of your show, and I'll give you a shout out on our network, my friend. Why not? 631-965-4990 is the number. As you know, this is Down to the Wire. We are live every single Monday and Tuesday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at night Eastern Time. I'm here with Speedy Crazy Petey sitting over here and dilly-dallying and, you know, getting ready to go out there and put his sales tactic together with his vibrator. So, guys, stay tuned for that.
Schnozenator. Schnozenator only.
No, that's what your nickname is. Schnozenator and Vibrating Champ. Nope. What would we call you? Nope. Vibrating?
Nope.
What do we call you?
Nope. Schnozenator.
No. The Schnozenator is a good name, but you're
it
Speedy
is.
Petey.
That's the name. That's no. Fine, but you could do Speedy Petey and Schnozenator.
No, I don't
Those
like
Those are
that.
The only acceptable things.
So you shoot snot out of your Schnozenator.
It's better than the other idea.
Woo! 631. Well, I'll give you the other number. 631-971-8070 is the other number to call if you want to call that number as well. Speedy, I want to get into this story because I wanted to get into the NFL free agency because a lot of people are asking me throughout social media, on my social media, when are we going to get into the NFL and the free agency market as far as the Jets are concerned, the Giants are concerned, and what the league is doing right now in free agency? I will tell you guys this. I really like what the Jets are doing right now. I was telling you about possible trade rumors right now with the Jets for a defensive lineman.
Yep, and they should do it. If those rumors are true, you don't have to give up.
Well, why don't you tell everybody the rumors?
So the rumor is Jacksonville, who just traded Calais Campbell, among other things this offseason, and really have done badly, are now trying to trade their recently franchise-tagged Yannick Ngakoue. And the rumor is the Jets will do it for a second-round pick this year and a third-round pick next year. And for somebody who's young, well-rounded, balanced, versatile, and very young still.
A pass rusher that the Jets haven't had forever.
The Jets should do that. Absolutely should do that.
So this is the conversation right now. The Jets are right now trying to make a move for a pass rusher, something they haven't had in since John Abraham. And they're going to get a guy in the prime of his career if they make this move. But again, you're talking about Joe Douglas giving away two valuable prospects in the future for the New York Jets. Maybe a big-time second-round draft pick this year. Could be an offensive lineman. Could be a wide receiver. Or you go after the guy that, you know, is a sure thing. A guy that's done it in the league for the last 4 years. He's going to be expecting a pretty big contract, especially if he goes into the year this year in his valued, you know, his valued free agency opens up after this year. So if the Jets are going to make this trade, they're going to have to sign him after this year if he has a good season.
I think they have to sign him right away if you're going to give up that much draft assets. Because again, even though you're not giving up a first round pick, those are two valuable picks that still should be starters on a football team.
So that's a story right now going on in Jet Camp or Jetville. But what I really want to get into is, and we're gonna put Jeff on, and Jeff's just got to hold on for 1 second, and Jeff will put you on in just 1 second. But I'll tell you guys this. When you look at the NFL free agency and how open it's been so far this offseason, it's been unbelievable. And I know the draft is, what is it, now 3 weeks away?
Mm-hmm. I think it's April 23rd.
And the way the NFL is doing, I think they're doing it the right way. They're not canceling the NFL draft. You could still draft players. You're just not going to have a fan base standing right over there screaming out your team's name and J-E-T-S or whatever the heck you're going to, Big Blue or the Patriot fans screaming out their names. And I don't think anybody cares about that. They care about where their teams are going in the draft. I just think the transition of the free agency market that we've seen this year has been fun and really could change the aftermath of where the league is going in this year's playoff runs, where there is going to be an extra team in both divisions, both leagues. So I'm interested to see what is going to happen this offseason for the rest of the offseason. But we have our second caller of the day. You guys know him as Jeff from Tampa. I know him as the sailor who sinks to the bottom of the ocean. What's going on, Jeff?
Dude, 100% the Jets should make that trade. If it's a second and a third for Yannick Ngakoue, 100% they should make that trade. The Jets are so historically bad at drafting second and third rounders. This would at least be like guaranteeing yourself that you could get someone that could play in the NFL.
Mm-hmm. Well, Joe Douglas is different. I think he's a different guy that when it comes to drafting. We'll have to see how he drafts.
That may be true, too, yes. But you would agree.
Stud pass rusher.
Historically, they have been pretty terrible at drafting second.
They probably have been, besides the Giants, the Jets and the Giants statistically in the last 30 years have been the worst two teams in the NFL in drafting. The worst.
The Giants, too.
The Jets and the Giants.
I would say the Browns were worse than the Giants.
No, the Browns.
Jacksonville.
There are more players that were drafted by the Browns in the last 30 years that were in a significant amount of time in the NFL than there were in the Giants organization and the Jets
organization. Yeah, that were good on other teams, probably. That doesn't say anything about the team.
I'm talking about players that they draft. That's what I'm talking about. And the Giants and the Jets are one of the worst organizations when it comes to drafting in the last 30 years in the later from the second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth round. So, again, you're absolutely right, Jeff. You just don't know what you're going to hit on.
I realize you think I'm taking a shot, but I'm going to say historically the Jets are so abysmal at getting a hit on a second or third round draft pick that, like, they'd be doing well to do this, I think. Mm-hmm.
No, this is if the Jets can land this, and this started, the conversation with this particular trade rumor started 9 hours ago. And now it's starting to take a spin over here. And the Jets were talking about Mike Williams making a trade with San Diego to bring in, not San Diego, the LA, the LA Chargers to bring in Mike Williams. And that fell apart about a week ago. They were trying to get Mike Williams, but this is a story and they need a pass rusher. They get a pass rusher. They solidify their front seven now. They have their pass rusher. They have C.J. Mosley back. You don't know what they're going to do with Avery Williamson. I've been hearing because they're so packed with the linebacker position, they might be willing to trade Avery Williamson.
But here's the thing, though. If they get Ngakoue, though, they can actually permanently shift to a 4-3 defense, which will help Williamson's value, being he's more of a base coverage type, fast type linebacker. He's not really the physical type of middle linebacker that CJ Mosley is, but he could be an outside guy that could be good in that type of base defense. The one Greg Williams ran well with the Rams when they had James Laurinaitis and Alec Ogletree and guys like that. So if they get Ngakoue, they could definitely do something like that and maybe just get another pass rusher later in the draft on the other side. And they can make that kind of thing work with Quinnen Williams as a defensive tackle.
It's going to be very, very interesting. But, Jeff, what did you think about so far? What have you thought about free agency and what you're seeing some of these teams? A lot of these teams taking chances with some players, even the Jets, I would say you got to give Joe Douglas a little bit of credit because he's bringing in players that they need that can fill in spots for very valuable contracts where you sign them for 3 years and you're pretty much just giving them $13, $14 million guaranteed in that contract, and you can opt out of that contract whenever you want. So what did you think about
I don't think the question for me with the Jets is...
I'm not even talking about the Jets.
Then who are you talking about?
I'm talking about what the league has shown you so far in free agency. I already know what the Jets... I'm just bringing up the Jets. We don't know what the Jets are or what Joe Douglas has done, but... he has made valuable moves at the prices he's got those valuable players for. So I think he's done very, very well with not superstar players, but bringing valuable assets to the team where you can absolutely use them going forward, going into this season.
Well, you know, we'll have to wait and with the Jets, I think it's a wait and see thing, and I think it's more unique than most teams, only for the fact that I'm not completely sold that Joe Douglas thinks that Adam Gase is the guy for that football team.
I don't think he does.
Like, but who knows who is going to fit in, in the way Adam Gase schemes, the offense and the defense and comes up with things. I think Joe Douglas is just trying to find what he believes are quality players and worrying about the fit later.
Mm-hmm. Well, go ahead.
Free agency is such a crapshoot because you really never know what you're getting with anybody, with any team. But I think especially the Jets, because I just don't believe that they quite know what they're doing just yet.
No, I agree with you. And you have a rookie GM that's never been a GM in the NFL. He's worked under some of the best GMs in professional football, no question, the last 15 years, he's worked under two GMs that have been very, very successful. You look what Philadelphia is doing this offseason. I'll tell you this right now. Philadelphia has been the most aggressive team this offseason, and they have gotten so much better. So much better in the NFC East compared to all those teams like the Cowboys, who everybody thinks right now are much better, but they gave Amari Cooper a 5-year, $100 million contract. They're going to still have to pay Dak Prescott. They've overpaid some of these players. The pass rusher last year.
They lost a lot on defense.
They lost a lot on defense, and this is not the same team that everybody thought was going to be the same team they were 2 years ago, going into this year.
Who are these people that believe that the Cowboys are doing good this offseason?
A lot of Cowboy fans, but I've also read a lot of things that other analysts have thought about what the Cowboys have done. They brought Poe in. I think that was a good move.
That was a good move.
Haha Dix was a good move. I mean, they've made some good acquisitions for very low prices, and they didn't really have to guarantee anything. These aren't long-term deals. I mean, Haha Dix is going to help their defense, especially the secondary.
Again, he might, but he's been so bad everywhere he's been, no one's wanted him.
Mm-hmm. No, he was really only bad with the Redskins. He was good with Green Bay, and he wasn't great with Chicago, but he was serviceable.
If that were the case, why isn't anyone keeping him ever, anywhere, on any team?
I agree.
Because I don't think a lot of teams need safeties right now. I think the market's really gone down for them.
I still think that Clinton Dix he's better than any player they had on their team, especially in their secondary.
Definitely with the safeties, yeah.
Definitely in their secondary.
I don't know if he's better than Byron Jones right now. But
Byron Jones stinks.
Mm.
Byron Jones is no longer with the organization.
Yeah, but, you know,
right, but that's
because
saying,
of money.
That's
that wasn't
saying,
because of...
It's a downgrade. I wouldn't want HaHa Clinton Dix over Byron Jones. And listen, they couldn't afford Byron Jones. He priced himself out for what the Cowboys had for salary cap. And that just is what it is. That happens to team salary cap casualties. But that's a downgrade, HaHa Clinton Dix, for, you know, in place of...
Byron Jones.
That's a downgrade.
But Errol's right. Errol's right. Where everybody else on that defense, HaHa Clinton Dix, at this point, or in that secondary, he's essentially an upgrade over everyone else.
He absolutely is an upgrade compared to all the other players they have. And Byron Jones, as much as everybody thinks Byron Jones was a good corner in the league, he had one great season. HaHa Clinton Dix was an All-Pro player. He was a Pro Bowl player for 3 years or 2 years in his career. He's a better player at his position. Now, he's not the same player he once was 3 years ago, but he's still, I think, a serviceable player that I think is not as – I don't think Byron Jones is that much better than
At this point, he is, but because he is a
well,
younger –
Well, what did Byron Jones do this year? What did he do?
He had a good year. He has a good number one corner year. The problem with Byron Jones is not that he's bad. It's just a problem he can only play one style because he's a smaller corner. So he's not going to be able to be physical. His ball skills are not going to be as good as top number one corners, but he's still a good coverage guy.
You know who Darrell Revis is, right?
Of course.
You know Darrell Revis wasn't a big guy either.
No.
He was 5'9", 5'10".
Right, but he was physical for a size.
Byron
Jones isn't like that. I know that.
Well, Byron Jones should be – he should try to transition his game like that because that's he wants to make big-time money. You're going to have to transition your game to be that top corner. You're not a top corner, and you think that you deserve corner money.
I'm not saying he's a top-five corner in football, but he's a number one corner, whereas HaHa Clinton Dix at this point is kind of a – maybe slightly above average, but still more middle of the road safety at this point.
I don't know. I think HaHa Clinton Dix still has a couple more years good left, and he can have a great season this year and become a Pro Bowl player again. He's got the ability to do that. Now, I don't know what he is or what he thinks he is now as an older player, but he's not even that old. I think HaHa Clinton Dix, he's 28, 29 years old. He's still fairly young at the safety position. So he could still play another 3-4 years and still be a serviceable player. So I don't know, man. I think Byron Jones was an overrated player. I'm not saying this because I don't hate.
Oh, he's
the
only 27. Okay.
Yeah, he's young. He's a young player. So he's had knee problems over the years, and we all know what he's had coming into league. He had knee problems.
That's what happens when you go to the Redskins.
Well, also we play for Alabama. Alabama, I think he had knee surgery. What didn't he have, Jeff? If I'm not mistaken, didn't he have knee surgery when he played for Alabama?
You know, I don't remember if he did or didn't. I'm not sure if he did, so I wouldn't be able to really tell you. You know,
I think he had meniscus surgery, if I'm not mistaken. But nevertheless,
But the people that say that the Cowboys are doing well, like, I mean. How do you know if they're doing well? Like, year in and year out, the Dallas Cowboys have one of the most talented teams. You know, they went and got Michael Bennett, and they went and had, you know, all these guys that were playing for them last year. And everyone couldn't believe, oh, my God, they're so talented. Oh, my God, they're so talented. What happened? They missed the playoffs. Like, they missed the playoffs. Like, it doesn't matter who they get. They went and got Gerald McCoy, too. Like, okay, Gerald McCoy, like, was he any good in Carolina last year?
No, he
not
wasn't.
Really. Gerald McCoy hasn't been good for a couple of years now.
I think Gerald McCoy was also misused, though, in Carolina, being that he's normally a pass-rushing defensive tackle, and they had him playing end, which is not his strength, really. And he's also regressed, really, as a run stopper, too.
Well, again, they're hoping for, you know, a guy that's just going to have an outstanding year and a better defense. That's what I think they're looking at Gerald McCoy. That's what they're looking at. Dontari Poe, he's still a good player.
Yeah, he's a
good run
stopper.
He's a nose
tackle. Right.
He's a good run stopper, which they had problems doing last year. You put him in the middle of your line, he can transition your line and completely change your line as a good run-stopping defense. So I do believe they have the pass rushers to be a good pass rushing team. I'm very interested to see what the Cowboys do this year, but even their free agency year has been pretty good. Green Bay, they didn't have a good offseason so far in free agency. Everybody thought that Green Bay...
I think Christian Kirksey was a good move, though. They needed help inside.
Yeah, but they lost a lot of players more than they gained players.
They lost Bulaga, who was an injury-prone tackle.
They lost Martinez.
They replaced Martinez with Kirksey, essentially. So that kind of washes, I guess. And I think they got a defensive lineman, so I'll look that up.
They didn't make any big acquisitions.
For me in the NFC, like the entire conversation about free agency, begins and ends with the NFC South. Like, every one of the teams in the NFC South got better. Emmanuel Sanders joined the Saints.
I don't think Atlanta got better. I don't know how the Falcons got better.
Buddy, it will definitely make them at least better. The Saints have never had a receiver on the other side of Michael Thomas. They had
I agree with the Saints. The Saints got better. I said Atlanta.
And, like, they had a bunch of bumps. You look at Tampa. Tampa went and got Tom Brady. Like him or not, that's a huge move. You know, Tampa Bay could have been really good last year. Jameis Winston wasn't the league's only 30-30 guy. You're going to definitely not throw 30 interceptions now this year.
That's not hard.
When you look at Carolina, getting Teddy Bridgewater and some of the other guys that they got, like, every team in the NFC South seems like they're going for it, and the rest of the teams in the other divisions haven't made nearly as much improvements as the teams in the
49ers got worse.
Well, I don't know if the Panthers really got better, though, because they lost Luke Kuechly, too. He was surprisingly retired.
You don't think Tom Brady over Jameis Winston is making them
better? I said the Saints and Bucks got better. I asked about Carolina and Atlanta. They didn't get better to me. The Falcons, I think, got a lot worse.
Yeah, the Falcons, yeah, you know, I mean, right, losing Austin Hooper and
Trufant and Freeman, anyways. They cut a lot. For whatever reason, they cut a lot. And they signed Dante Fowler, who had he was the same kind of player as Vic Beasley. So I don't think they got better. In Carolina, they lost a lot because of, again, Kuechly retiring and the front office.
I was very surprised Kuechly retired. I really was. But this is also a guy that doesn't want to be brain dead when he's at the age of 50. He came out and said that in a GQ magazine a couple of years ago, that he doesn't see his career in the NFL going too long moving forward because of the whole CTA and the injuries that he had. He's had how many injuries with his legs, his back? I mean, this guy, and Luke Kuechly is a Hall of Famer. You look at his numbers, he's been the top three linebacker in football for the last 7 years.
I would say right after Patrick Willis retired, he got the top spot after that.
He's
so from
been
2015 so, to this year. He's the best middle linebacker in football.
So to me, he's a Hall of Famer. Maybe he hasn't done it as long as everybody expected.
That's what's worrisome with everyone else.
But I think Luke Kuechly will make it because he's a fan favorite, and I think they really, really love him. So
The biggest key with that is to see if these other guys who did retire earlier will get into. If it becomes a more prominent trend, I think you'll see it. It might take a while for that
to happen. Andrew Luck didn't do it long enough.
Well, I'm not even talking about Andrew Luck. I'm talking about Calvin Johnson, Patrick Willis, Marshawn Lynch, guys like that talent-wise, they're not borderline. They're Hall of Famers.
It's a shame. It is a shame.
We have to see if the NFL will adjust it, the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
It's a shame to me when you look at guys like Andrew Luck. A lot of these young kids are never going to remember Andrew Luck because Andrew Luck wasn't in the game long enough for you to remember him. And I think Andrew Luck really did that to himself, but also it hurts the league because when you're looking at the next transitional quarterback, you used to think Andrew Luck. Now you're thinking more of the Russell Wilson of the world, you look at that draft. Andrew Luck, RG3, RG3, who's a backup, he's going to be a backup quarterback for the rest of his career, and Andrew Luck that retired. So the two best quarterbacks, the 1 and 2 quarterbacks in that draft that everybody thought were going to be completely game changers, are no longer really playing in the NFL. Then you talk about the Jameis Winston and Marcus Mariota draft; those guys were 1 and 2 in their draft. Where are these guys? They're never going to be starters in the NFL again. Marcus Mariota will never start on another team again. And Jameis Winston, forget about it. You're talking about, look at the bust that we've seen at 1, 2, and 3 in the draft over year after year after year after year. It shows you it's not easy to find a valuable franchise quarterback. It is completely changed. The NFL is completely changed. Finding a guy that can take the pressure, make the plays in the big game, that's not easy to find. That's what makes guys like Drew Brees and Tom Brady and even Peyton Manning so special. It's not easy to do. Even Eli Manning. Those games are not easy to come by and go into those games and win those games. It's not easy. That's why football, as much as I can't stand what Roger Goodell has done with the CTE thing, they're never going to lose where they are in position. But there are going to be other leagues with the way that, you know, the parents are trying to push away from the kids from football. You're going to see other leagues like basketball and baseball move forward, and ratings wise are going to get better.
But they're still not going to be number one. I'm sorry.
We'll see.
Definitely not baseball.
We'll see. Jeff, what do you think?
I mean, it'll be interesting to see where the ratings are, right? Because of the unique situation that we are in right now in life, just in general, I really do believe baseball, if they come back on July 4th, which is the date they're shooting for, if they come back on July 4th and they don't cancel the season, baseball's really going to be in a unique position where everyone's going to have been deprived of sports for so long that they're really going to have a marketing coup and really might be able to really cash in on drawing a bunch of fans back. And I mean, think about how highly rated the very first ESPN Sunday night baseball game is going to be when they come back.
Right, but will it be the same long term? Because his argument last week was baseball is going to take over as the most popular sport.
Well, listen, I think that, you never really know because, hockey was never at, a higher point in life than, 97 and 98. And then hockey had a strike and it really never recovered.
Nope.
Right? So you never know what kind of marketing push can do for a sport. This could, I'm not saying that it's going to be, but done right and with the right marketing and show the right games on TV, this really could be something that launches baseball back into the forefront of American sports.
I agree with you. I think baseball is right there. And I think they have the quality of players still in the game where they can transition back into the number one sport in America. I do believe
it might
could
be short term. I just don't know if it'll be long term.
Why? Because people are complaining about football right now with the rules and the transition of the game. It's become more of a girlish game. I think it's going to change. And parents do not want their kids involved with the game
of
football.
I don't think that'll influence them watching him.
We'll see.
I just think that baseball's in a unique position. Like, if I'm working for Major League Baseball right now, I'm doing everything I can to plan all kinds of crazy things for when baseball comes back. I mean, I think they're still shooting for a July 4th date. Who knows if that'll happen or not with the way things are spiraling out of control right now, but they're really, we haven't had sports for what, 2 weeks? Mm. And people have already lost their minds dying for any kind of sporting event on TV right now.
We've lost sports longer than 3 weeks. I mean, 2 weeks. I think we've lost.
Well, I think the first initial shutdown was, I think, Friday of 2 weeks ago. So, yeah, sounds right. When all the conference tournaments were shut down and then the NBA and then I think NHL and MLB did it the same day as when the last NCAA conference tournament shut down, which I think was 2 weeks ago, Thursday.
Right. So I mean, people are going to be at a fever pitch to see some sort of
sport
competition on TV, by July 4th. And I really think done right, with an abbreviated schedule and get the right matchups on TV, I think it really could. We had this discussion before about how Mike Trout could basically walk down the street and no one would really recognize him.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This might be an opportunity to get him on TV and change that.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Will it change it to become the number one sport is the other question.
Why not? Sports has transitioned so many different ways in the way the games have changed. Why couldn't it do that? I think it could do that. Absolutely.
I just don't see football consumption dropping off, though, either.
Well, I'm not saying that it will, but baseball could be right there with it.
Right, but it's all going to depend on the market and what you do with your national TV schedule and the matchups that you bring back for the script. Like, if you put the Mets on TV, no one's going to care. No one is on the Mets that anyone wants to see. No one cares.
Mm-hmm. No one's on the Mets because half their team is hurt.
Well, Pete Alonso's still there, and Pete Alonso's a fan favorite now, and he's turned by the go ahead.
It's a joke. Pete Alonso has had one, and it was a great season. But Pete Alonso has had one good season.
He's a good kid.
The Mookie Betts is on TV with that Dodgers team. You need to get Mike Trout on TV. You need to get the marquee guys like Christian Yelich in Milwaukee.
Mm-hmm.
You need to get them on TV.
Aaron Judge.
Really market your superstars.
Mm-hmm. And Pete Alonso could be a superstar. He absolutely could.
He could be, but I'm not. He could be. I'm not calling him that yet. No. I'm sorry,
yeah.
And I know that you're on Long Island and
No. I'm a straightforward guy. I think Pete Alonso could be a superstar, and he proved last year. And I like what he's saying right now this offseason. He's really been a spokesman, not for just for the Mets, but Major League Baseball. I love what he has to say. I think he's a good kid, and I think he's a quality person that the Mets definitely need to build their team around. But we have to see him do it in multiple years.
Right. Chris Davis had 52 home runs. Now he has the worst contract in baseball. So let's hope that doesn't happen.
200 times. Is everyone going to be calling Pete Alonso a superstar?
No. No, I'm not saying that he is. I'm just saying that he could be. And he's still very young.
He's still very young, and he had a terrific season, and he hit a lot of home runs. And it was great for the Mets, and it was great for him, and they made a terrific run at the end of the year last year. I'm not trying to shit on anything that they did, but to be a star, you really need to put a couple of seasons like that together in a row, like Mike Trout has, like all these other guys have that are stars in the game that aren't going to fade. You don't want to, you know, you don't want to be featuring the Mark Pryors and the Kerry Woods of the world that are, you know, have a great season, and then they're never heard of again.
The Speedy Petey's of the world.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's going to defend the Mets till the day he dies because he's a Mets fan.
No, I know how statistical anomalies work, Jeff.
But I don't think what I'm saying is all that crazy. Like, no one wants to watch the Mets. Nobody wants to watch them. People want to see the Dodgers on TV. You go up and down that Dodgers lineup, there's stars all through it. I'd like to.
You go up the Dodgers, look at the Dodgers bench, there's all-star caliber players on it.
Right, that's what I'm saying. I could tune into a Dodgers game and be happy to watch Max Muncy. I think Max Muncy's a really interesting player. Like, you know, it's not that Pete Alonso isn't, but like the rest of the guys on that Mets team, I couldn't give two damns about because they're no good.
Interesting.
Right. The Mets' best chance of getting any eyeballs on any games this year is just calling up Tim Tebow. You laugh, but how true is that? If
it's a scary thought.
If you took a Mets opening day roster, right, and you injected Tim Tebow into that, what's the percentage of more ticket sales and more eyeballs would be more interested in that game just because terrible Tim Tebow is playing in that game?
I know. It's a scary thought. That's how sad the Mets are as a player development organization.
But that's also the Mets. Right. They're an organization that tries to find little schemes that they can sell to the public and sell to the fans. That's been the Mets, forte. It's been the Yankees' forte over the years, but they actually have players on their team that they can sell.
Right.
But Pete Alonso is a sellable. I do believe the Mets have a selling player. I mean, Jacob DeGrom, he's a great player. He's a superstar pitcher.
He won't be playing this year.
What happened?
Oh, I'm sorry, not him.
No, Noah Syndergaard. No, I'm talking about Jacob DeGrom. He's their big time arm. He's the superstar. He's two back to back Cy Youngs. I mean, the last person to do that was Tom Seaver, I think, right, with the Mets. So
basically what you're telling me is once a week the Mets are watchable.
No, what I'm saying is they now have a player, not of a pitcher status that we've been talking about.
Because all their previous stars they and have flashy young players have been pitchers, because that's how their organization
is. And I like McNeil, too, but I don't care about...
But McNeil's not going to be the flashy star that people are going to want to watch.
I like...
He's a good player. He's not a big name, though.
I like Pete Alonso because the guy speaks from his heart, and he goes out there and he puts it on the field. And that's what I like about Pete Alonso. Right. That's superstar qualities, you know?
The only way I can describe this Mets team, and I realize you're going to yell at me and say it's so disingenuous and call me all kinds of names, Speedy, but the Mets were a glorified AAA team where you're being promised these guys could all turn into stars. Oh, they have the potential to. Who wants to go and watch a AAA baseball game? It's not like you're, every guy has potential, right? Every team has guys with potential. But, that's all the Mets are promising. It's just a bunch of young guys. Well, let's see what they maybe can do.
That's the problem they've had is they've had trouble developing position players consistently, so that can't happen. And they have to resort to short contracts and maybe AAA type players.
There are so many more teams besides the Mets that I would want to tune in and watch. God bless the Mets. They got a bunch of promising young players on that team that could turn into something, but they're not there yet. So why would, if you're going to market baseball, you want to put your best foot forward coming out of this quarantine kind of life we're living in right now, and really market the shit out of baseball and put your best foot forward. That means Brewers-Dodgers matchups every night.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing what baseball is going to do, and I think it's going to be very interesting. I don't like the way basketball thinks they're going to change the playoffs this year because of the coronavirus. And I'm if I were the NHL right now, if you think that you can't have a full-fledged playoff run for the NHL, then don't even have a playoff run and just go into the next season. It. That's what I think.
I mean, let's face it. Basketball and hockey are done. They're done. Mm-hmm. They're done. They're not coming back to play an NBA Finals in August to try to turn around and orchestrate some sort of semblance of a draft and a mini camp and a season on time for October. You might as well just consider this like a lockout or a strike, and it is a labor stoppage, and we basically had a half of a season, and it's not coming back, and they'll restart a brand new season in October or November or whenever they start.
I agree. I don't think they should have a basketball or a hockey rest of the season. I think they should just cancel it, go into baseball in June or July, and get ready for football. And basketball and hockey start up pretty quick in October. So I think that's what I think the NBA and the NHL should do, and they should go on to have their drafts and do what they do best in drawing more fans in next year's season and go forward, moving forward that way. That's what I think. Jeff, thank you for calling, buddy.
Buddy, always a pleasure. Thank you for having me. I'm glad I could shit on everything New York tonight.
Thank you.
The Jets stink. The Mets stink. You know, it's like you're taking the place of the bead from me.
Thank you, Jeff. Jeff from Tampa, ladies and gentlemen. Very interesting guy, that's for sure. When we come back, we will get into Debate Hour here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Is the number. This song is one of my favorite songs. I'm not gonna sing this song anymore. Oh, oh. Speedy smells like a big fat horseman. That's why he will not clean his underwear, because he's over himself. I know he is.
What, you don't like the track?
No, I don't like the track.
Horseman.
Yeah. Horseman. Oh, this is great, man, Speedy. Anyway, 631-965-4990 is the number.
I was creative, though, singing the number into the song.
I did, but I didn't, you know, I got to definitely set this up where I could actually add my words to a song, and it'd be really, really funny, and then we can actually cut it up, you know? That's what we need to do. Anyways, remember, you can follow us by going to our website at worldwidesportsradio.com. Here we go, Speedy.
This is the Debate Hour. And now in this corner, your host, Errol Marks. And in this corner, who gives a shit? Round one.
All right, Speedy, hit me with it.
All right, we got three debates today. Round one is our first and only NBA debate. Which big man would you take from the past to succeed the most in today's NBA with today's NBA rules and players?
All right, Speedy.
So I am going to take Kareem Abdul-Jabbar for this. I'm going to take Kareem Abdul-Jabbar for two reasons here. One of which is, again, he was famous on pioneering the skyhook shot for big men, which, again, in today's game might have regressed a little bit, but, again, with the game being an offensive league, with the game being more of a shooting league, I feel like he has a good chance to learn that kind of shot and expand his range most of all. And again, the way he spaces, it'll be a lot easier than in the time he played when there was better defensive players back then. The league as a whole with the rules were a lot different. And he would probably go to the line a lot more too. And I think that would end up making a difference for his career, which was already a great career anyway. He was arguably the second or third best player and probably the best big man of all time. Arguably the second or third best player of all time. I think his passing numbers with big men passing more would make a difference. He was averaging in some years 4 and 5 assists a season, when he was with Milwaukee. When he was with the Lakers, it kind of died off a little bit because of Magic Johnson ball handling, but he was still averaging some seasons, 4.3 assists in 1977, 4.5 in 1979, 1980, where that was still happening. So I do think you'll see end up seeing that make a difference with his size, and I think with the sky hook, he could definitely learn the mid-range game a lot more, and even maybe the three-point game, if he were hypothetically in today's NBA and born in that time. So I think his skill set all around, just his well-roundedness as a big man, and the way the rules are, I think he would definitely benefit off of that the most.
Believe it or not, I think Kevin Garnett would benefit on the rules in these game, in this day of game, this day and age. I'll tell you why. Listen, Kevin Garnett was great going up and down the court. For a big man, 6'11", he would go up and down the court as fast as any big man in the league. He could play multiple positions, and he had a good mid-range shot later in his career. He was hitting his 16, 15-foot jumpers. If he actually worked on his jump shot early in his career, this guy probably would have been a pretty good three-point shooter in the NBA. The guy has amazing skills inside and out of his game. Like, the NBA is trying to transition these guys like the Greek Freak and Anthony Davis to be mid-range shooters. That's how you're going to be successful as a big man in the league. Kevin Garnett became a good mid-range shooter early in his career. Not even later in his career. Usually 5-6 years into his career, Kevin Garnett had a good mid-range shot, especially when he went to the Boston Celtics. I just think his game would have transitioned even better into the NBA style of game than some of these guys in the old age. Because this guy not only was very athletic, the guy could go up and down the court as fast. He ran up and down the court as fast as Porzingis does. I mean, he's not a Tim Duncan. He's not a Wilt Chamberlain. He's not even a Russell. These guys, these big men, it took them a little while to get down and structure their defensive style of game. Kevin Garnett was a good defensive player and transitioning into a good offensive player. His game really changed when the game changed offensively. I think if his game was fully in this type of style of game early in his career, he would have been a better NBA player and probably a better Hall of Famer. So Kevin Garnett would be my guy.
All right, here we go. Round two.
Round two.
Shifting to the NFL now. Outside of quarterback, which position in the NFL do you think is the most important when building a championship caliber team? So this is interesting. I think it's definitely defensive. I'm gonna take a defensive end or a pass rusher if you want to use a 3-4 defense and outside linebacker. I was considering taking corner for this one because I think it is very important in today's NFL too in a very big passing league. But I am still going to take the pass rusher also because of the way the outside game, the screen game is a lot more prominent now. A lot of quarterbacks now with the RPO offenses. It's a quick game. So defensive linemen shutting down screen passes, being fast and tackling in space, I think really makes a big difference. In addition to rushing the passer too, which is always important no matter what era of football you are. If you make a quarterback comfortable, he's going to have a lot more time to throw the ball. It'll allow sophisticated routes to happen. And with the way offensive coaches are, young offensive coaches, there are a lot more complicated systems like that. And also, again, screen defenders, motion offenses, in terms of stopping receivers running, running backs outside, running backs catching passes. Those are very important now in today's game, where I don't know if you're going to get that as much with other positions. You can have it with linebackers at times and safeties, but again, those are usually also based on what you end up doing. You need to be able to rush the passer, and you need to be able to do all these things on the first level to create a new defense in the NFL, especially with mobile quarterbacks now. So I think corners are important too. You need to have good corners to stop top receivers and even tight ends to an extent now. But I think a slight edge will go to defensive linemen or outside of pass rushers.
Teams are built in the trenches. I think the offensive tackle is the second most important position. That's protecting the quarterback, the number one target, the number one guy that you're building your organization around. If you have a number one guy as good as guys like Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, Drew Brees, you need to build it with the offensive line. Like I said, it's built in the trenches. Yes, you need a good pass rush. Yes, you need good corners to win championships because the league has changed into a throwing league. But to have an offensive lineman that's going to protect that guy, that's going to give you the time to make the plays in the open field, that's what you need. You need to build that offensive line, that presence of a family that's going to protect their main target, their main guy, the main brass of that organization is the quarterback that's going to lead them forward for their organization for the next 10, 15 years. So I believe it's the offensive tackle. It's not a pass rusher. Yes, you can win. You need great defenses to win championships. You need good corners to win championships. But you need the offensive tackle that's going to protect the quarterback, that's going to make you move further into the playoffs, because you're going to give the quarterback the time and the presence in the pocket to make the plays.
All righty. Round three, the last one. Which player in today's NFL is most comparable on and off the field to Terrell Owens? Now, this is interesting. I'm actually going to take this into a different direction. I'm actually not going to take a wide receiver at all. I'm going to take Jalen Ramsey for this one. And I say this for multiple reasons, one of which is both him and Terrell Owens throughout their careers had big mouths. They love to trash talk. They love to say certain things. And that's why, as a result, they've had trouble staying on the certain teams. Now, obviously, Jalen Ramsey was on Jacksonville for 4 years, and Terrell Owens started with the Niners for, I think, 6 years. But, again, a lot of the players before that in the 2013 drafts, the 2014 drafts before that, they didn't really bump around teams that long. So you have to pick somebody that's probably from the 16 draft on, because that's when these players are starting to become more stubborn. And again, both of them are dominant players at their position. Jalen Ramsey's a top five corner in football. Arguably, I think, the most talented corner in football when judging his skill set. And he shows it on the field, just like Terrell Owens showed it on the field when he was a wide receiver. And he's a top three wide receiver of all time. But at the same time, he also talked a lot. And I also think, in a way, these players have also gotten unfairly criticized, too, to some extent. Jalen Ramsey, I think, got unfairly criticized for his quarterback comments. I think those were more funny than anything else. Just the most random things. And Terrell Owens, kind of the same thing. The Hall of Fame incident, obviously, throughout his career with the star thing. He got criticized for a lot of things that I think got overblown, kind of like what Jalen Ramsey has done. Both of them are trash talkers, but both of them show it on the field too. And both of them are characters, and I think that really makes a difference. And Ramsey, don't be surprised if he gets moved again from the Rams, who they're starting to become the Dolphins, in my opinion, with the way their cap issues are. So don't be surprised if he starts to want out of there too, just like Brandon Cooks has already said, as well as obviously they cut Todd Gurley. So don't be surprised if he's going to another team, just like T.O. did after he left the Niners and went to the Eagles, then to the Cowboys and wherever else. So I'm going to take Jalen Ramsey. As much as it's not a wide receiver, I'm going to take Ramsey.
Now, I'm going to pick this guy, not because of his talent or what he's done on the field in a little bit of time he's been in the league, but his mouth and what he does on and off the field and gets himself into trouble. Speaks very highly of himself and his team, but his team has done nothing. And that is Baker Mayfield. When you look at Baker Mayfield coming into the league, he spoke very highly of the Browns and talking highly of Odell Beckham this year, like they're going to explode right off the field once they step on the field. They did not do the things that they thought they were going to do this year with the talent that they had. Baker Mayfield still spoke very highly of his team, his players, caused trouble in and out of his locker room, not with only his offensive players, but with his defensive players too. At the end of the season, there were stories coming out that him and Odell Beckham were not getting along in the locker room. Who does that sound like? It sounds like Terrell Owens. Everywhere he went, any player that he played with, no matter how talented they were and how much he loved him, Donovan McNabb with Terrell Owens, he spoke very bad about Donovan McNabb after the game, and then he would tell him he'd cry about his quarterback, that he was all about the quarterback. He'd have his back no matter what, but he'd speak to the press so badly about him. Baker Mayfield's the same player. He loves to speak highly of himself. He had one good season. I'm not talking about talent. Terrell Owens was one of the greatest wide receivers of all time. I don't even think Baker Mayfield's even going to sniff the Hall of Fame. So, to me, it's just his presence on and off the field. Baker Mayfield likes to cause trouble on the field, says whatever he does, and barks on the sidelines, just like Terrell Owens has done over the years. And that's why you took somebody that wasn't the position at wide receiver, and I took a guy that I believe is the same type of player on the field, but as a quarterback. I just think Baker Mayfield has not put up what Terrell Owens has put up, but he also hasn't shut up, and that's the problem. Terrell Owens never shut up. He always put up, but he never shut up. And at the end of his career, when he wasn't putting up, he really wasn't the player that anybody thought he was going to be. So before we go, we have another guest. As you guys know him as the Beef from Bayshore. Well, you know him as Mike from Bayshore. I know him as the Beef. What's going on, Beef?
What's up, my friend? I'm sitting here listening to this debate thing, and I'm surprised that you didn't pick a guy like Odell Beckham.
I knew you were going to say, because everybody would...
He has a mouth also, and he's created a lot of problems on the sideline.
Oh, and I know a lot of people expected us to do that. That's why I didn't want to pick Odell Beckham, because that was somebody that me and Speedy probably would have argued, because a lot of people compare Odell Beckham to Terrell Owens, but Odell Beckham can't stay on the field. Terrell Owens played for 9-10 years of consistency on the field that barely got hurt. I mean, the last time I remember Terrell Owens being hurt was going into the Super Bowl with the Eagles with a broken foot. And having the game,
they had 139 yards or whatever he had.
Beckham's the top, when healthy, Beckham's the top five receiver in the NFL. Mm-hmm. No?
Definitely.
I don't know. I'm not a big fan of Odell Beckham, and I don't think he's a top five anymore. I think there are other guys that I would take over in front of him.
I just think, well, right now I think he's on the wrong team. He's not in the right system. So.
Well, I think he's been on the wrong team his whole career.
Well, we'll have to see.
He needs to be on Odell Beckham's team.
We'll have to see, because he's been around that even when he was with the Giants. He played for 2 years with Coughlin, who was a very good coach. Mm-hmm. But then he had bad coaching after that. Then he had Freddie Kitchens, who was the worst coach in football last year. So
I understand what you're saying about Owens, but I mean, to me, Beckham is just as big as a head case as Terrell Owens is.
And you keep talking about Ben McAdoo, and I'm sorry. I'm sitting here and I listen to all these Ben McAdoo haters. Ben McAdoo said that Eli Manning's career was over. He got rid of him. He put the wrong guy in the position. But Davis Webb, and I said this the other day, Davis Webb was never going to be in the NFL that long either. So putting Geno Smith over Davis Webb, at least Geno Smith is still playing in the NFL as a backup.
That doesn't matter.
Davis Webb,
we know what Geno Smith is already.
It doesn't matter.
He had a decent rookie year, and that was it.
He obviously didn't think that Davis Webb was going to be any good. That's why Davis Webb wasn't on the field.
I'd rather have him try with somebody unknown than guy we know is going
to
be bad.
Well, you don't have to scream in the mic because you're just a complete moron and you're a Giant fan that would think that stupid.
He definitely made the wrong move. I'm sorry. I mean, he definitely made the wrong move. He should have put
Ben McAdoo was not a bad coach because he had one bad season. He was 11-5 his first season. He was 5-11
because of the defense.
That was because of the defense. Yeah. It was also because of the offense. Eli Manning never had statistically the numbers that he's ever had. And if you look at Odell Beckham's numbers have never been the same since that season. So I don't know what you're talking
about.
Yeah,
it's because of the injury.
That was because of the offense.
Injury.
The offense was one of the top 10 offenses in the league.
No, it wasn't. They had, I think, more than half the games, they scored less than 20 points. That's
really?
Not top
in the second
offense.
Of the season? In the last six games of the season?
Mm-hmm. They were winning a lot with defense.
I'm sorry. I beg to differ on that. So, as far as I'm concerned, I look at Baker Mayfield. I think he's been a big head case over the years.
I'm not saying he's not, but I still think Beckham is still more of a head case than anybody on the team.
I beg to differ, because Odell Beckham still, even with the season that he had last year, he had a pretty good season. Baker Mayfield had a crappy season, and this is a guy that was talking crap forever and ever and ever.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Speedy. Go look at
them. They're 26th in points, 25th in yards.
Oh, and that makes them bad.
Yeah.
That made them bad. They were 11-5, and their offense was
pretty
good.
Because of their defense.
In their second half of the season, they were very good. You don't have the second half numbers, but in the second half of the season, the last five or six games of the season, they were one of the best offensive teams in football.
Let's see. So in the second half of the season, so that's after we'll do that after the week 8 bye week. They scored 28 on the Eagles. Okay, fine. They had 302 total yards of offense, which is average. 21-20, they beat the Bengals. 351 yards, 21 points. Both kind of, I mean, 351 is probably above average, and 21 is very average. A Bears team that was very bad that year. Their defense was really bad. Mm. 329 yards, 22 points. Yeah, not great. The Browns, who were a one-win team, let's see, they only had 296 yards against and 27 points, which one of which was a defensive touchdown. The Steelers, they lost. They scored 14 points, 234 yards. The Cowboys, they won 10-7, 260 yards of offense. The Lions, they won 17-6, 300 yards of offense. They lost to the Eagles the next week. They had 470 yards, but they only had 19 points. Bad red zone play calling on, Ben McAdoo. And then the last game of the season, they beat the Redskins 19-10 with 332 yards of offense.
Yeah, 332,
which
yards
is average.
Average. They're still their numbers. Go look at all the other teams that year. Go look at all the other teams in the second half of the season. And they won the majority of the games in the second half
because
of
their defense.
Their defense wasn't as good as you're making them out to be. They had great stats. I think they were second or third all purpose.
I think they were second yardage and fifth points, if I remember correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a really good defense.
And their offense made plays.
You said Beckham's not a top five receiver anymore. Why?
I don't. I don't. I don't think he's a top five wide receiver.
Why don't you think that?
Because Odell Beckham hasn't really shown me in the last couple of seasons where you can put him in the top five. I mean, his numbers, if you're an elite wide receiver, you're going to do elite things. In Odell Beckham, the last two seasons has not been elite. I mean, he's coming back from an injury.
What was his numbers last year?
Go look at Odell Beckham's numbers, Speedy, instead of looking at something that makes no sense to what we're looking at.
They were 10th in yardage and
second points. Go look at Odell Beckham's numbers.
Oh, my God. You want me to tell you they had no defense, but they were second in points, and they were second best run defense.
And you said they have no offense, but they had most of the games they had 300 purpose yards. So
that's average in today's game.
Really? Average in today's game?
That's very average in today's game.
Really?
Yes, really.
Average in today's
game. It's an offensive league.
Go ahead, Speedy. Get me Odell Beckham's numbers.
All right, from which year?
Last year.
All right. He had 74 catches, 1,035 yards, four touchdowns.
That's not a top five wide receiver.
What was the year before? He was hurt the year before.
He was hurt the year before.
He was here the year before. 12 games. He had 77 catches, 1,052 yards, and six touchdowns.
That's not a top to me. That's not.
For 13 games, that's. Or 12 games. 12 games, that's pretty good. That's on pace. If he's averaging 87.
Speedy, I'm not talking about pace. I'm talking about what he did that year. He had four touchdowns, six touchdowns for 1,052 and 1,035. That's
for
not
12
elite.
Games?
That's not elite.
That's
not
really
elite.
Good for 12 games.
That's not yeah, and if you look at the games, he had big games in like three or four games and some games that he did terrible in. Okay,
well,
so.
What year was his breakout? What was his best year?
His best year was probably 2015, 96 catches, 1,450 yards, and 13 touchdowns.
He had three great seasons back-to-back-to-back years, and then he had 302, 1,052, and 1,035. To me, those aren't elite wide receiver numbers.
But he was also held back by awful coaching and bad offensive lines.
And
the Browns had a bad offensive line.
And that's not an excuse. That's not an excuse. My excuse here is he's not a top five wide receiver, as far as I'm concerned, in the last two seasons. He's not. Now, is he a top 10? Yes, he's probably six or seven. But I'm not putting him in my top five because, again, if you want me to put numbers together, let's put AJ Green. Besides the last 2 years, AJ Green's numbers has been elite numbers throughout his career. AJ Green, if you want to put him, I don't think Odell Beckham's even anywhere close to what AJ Green is in his career.
Maybe if you're comparing the two primes, but we're comparing now. We're not talking about legacy here. I think we're talking about...
All right, 2017 when he played, he had 1,078 yards.
Okay, which is pretty similar to what Odell had in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
And he wasn't
a top five wide receiver that year either.
Right, but he played all 16 games that year. So we're comparing A.J. Green's 17 season with
Beckham's
18
season. Nobody's complaining about Odell Beckham's
injury.
Odell
played 12 games.
Again, and he's an injury-prone player, so to me...
So is A.J. Green.
AJ Green was not a pro. He wasn't an injury player later early in his career. He played 15, 16, 16, 13, 16, 10,
yeah,
16, 9.
Early in his career,
he was consistent.
Yeah,
he was consistent.
Beckham's what? How old?
27, I think.
You could say whatever you want, Speedy. Odell Beckham is not a top five wide receiver in this
league. How old is Beckham?
But then who is? It's not AJ Green, not anymore.
I didn't say AJ Green.
Okay, so, all right. Hopkins, Michael Thomas, Julio Jones. Who else would you put above them? I'm just curious.
Who?
DeAndre Hopkins, Michael Thomas, and Julio Jones. Those are the three I will be willing to put above them.
The kid on Tampa I put over him.
Mike Evans.
Yep.
He's a little inconsistent for my liking, but again, talent-wise, he's up there.
Go look at his numbers to Odell Beckham's the last 3 years. They're better. A lot better. Who else would I take over in front of Hill? I would take Tyreek Hill. Over Odell Beckham.
A guy who has Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid to help him. Okay.
Okay. Tyreek Hill has better numbers. And again, I'm looking at numbers and I'm looking at statistics of what we're trying to do and comparing to. I don't want to hear about the coach. They wanted the coach there. I don't want to hear about the ownership over there. Everybody thought they were Super Bowl contenders with the talent that they had and they didn't have it. So go ahead, Mike Evans. What is his
numbers? Mike Evans had a great 18 season, 86 catches, 15, 24, and 8 touchdowns. So that was better than anything Odell's had recently. Last year, 67 for 1,157.
Better than Odell
touchdowns.
And had the same amount of games that they played. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 13 games. Mm-hmm. Okay.
If you want to call that numbers, I mean, Cooper had better numbers than Odell. So.
Yeah, but Cooper also had some really dud years, too.
Just go with the numbers. In the last two or three years, he's had better numbers than Odell Beckham.
Cooper has a better numbers than Odell.
So there you go. Tyreek Hill, and Tyreek Hill is in front of Odell Beckham, too.
Did Amari Cooper have to play with Freddie Kitchens as his coach and a terrible offensive line?
Speedy, who had better numbers?
Okay, you have to judge circumstances. Otherwise, you don't get targets.
I don't,
or you don't get good throws.
I don't think Amari Cooper is right there with Odell Beckham. I don't, but I think Amari Cooper's right there.
All right,
we're talking about numbers,
Mike.
Right?
All right. You want to see his 2018 season, Mike? 75 catches, 1,005 yards, and 7 touchdowns. in 15 games, which is not better than Odell's 18 season when he played 12 games in any of those numbers, maybe besides catch rate. But again, he didn't have to play with a terrible offensive line. Oakland had a good offensive line.
It doesn't matter what they're playing with, Greedy. They're out there.
Circumstance matters. You don't get targets on good throws otherwise.
Just look at numbers. That's it. Look at numbers.
Mike, I like Amari Cooper. He's not better than Odell.
No, I didn't think that he is, but I think Tyreek. I think Tyreek Hill is, and I think Mike Evans is. I think both of them are. I think Mike Evans and Tyreek Hill are both wide receivers better than Odell Beckham now. I think they move in front of Odell Beckham because of the last two seasons.
Odell would put up the numbers that's not Julio Jones and
that's not
Michael Thomas has put up in recent years if he had Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid. I'm sorry.
Well, that's not what we're talking about.
He's a lot more skilled than Tyreek Hill.
That's not what we're talking about. If you look at Odell Beckham's numbers, you can look at Odell Beckham's numbers when he had Ben McAdoo coaching him. You're going to complain about that? You think Ben McAdoo's a terrible coach?
Yes.
Go look at his numbers. Go look at his numbers.
Okay. 2016, he was good. 101 catches, 1367, and 10 touchdowns. Mm-hmm. 2017, he was hurt. Okay.
That was when he was fired. 302.
Right. Okay. And then he had Pat Shurmur after that. Pat Shurmur's not a good coach either.
Again, I think McAdoo, if you look at Odell Beckham, his second best season was with Ben McAdoo. So what are you going to say about that? Oh, he's a terrible coach?
Okay.
Terrible coach, Speedy? Go ahead, say it.
Yes, he is a terrible coach.
You're a terrible idiot. That's what you are.
Yeah, because he was the entire offense that year. Who was their running backs? Who were their tight ends? They didn't have anyone like that. Their offensive line was terrible.
That's not my argument.
He got all the targets.
That's not my argument.
His catch percentage was 59.8 because most of the time he was force-fed.
Yeah, he's force-fed. So you're looking at numbers and you're going to tell me because he was force-fed in the numbers that you're seeing.
He's the only weapon on that team.
Could you stop screaming on the mic? I'm going to put my foot in your ass.
Oh, that's funny.
You're an idiot. I keep telling you to stop screaming. And you're
Cooper
screaming at the top
Beckham.
Of your lungs. I think
I'm
we can hear
Cooper
you pretty well.
Beckham. I'm just saying that Cooper had better numbers in the last 2 years than Beckham did. That's all.
Cooper did not have better numbers in 2018. He did last year. He had more touchdowns. Their catch and yard numbers were pretty close, though. And again, Freddie Kitchens is the one calling plays with a terrible offensive line. That'll happen.
So I had Jason Garrett calling plays.
Okay, and a good offensive line.
I'm not blaming that. So just saying.
All right. I'm just saying bad coaches cancel out. Fine. Dallas has a good offensive line. The Browns had a terrible offensive line. That matters in terms of getting quality within your targets and good red zone looks. The Browns also had a ton of guys stealing red zone targets because they also have Nick Chubb. They also have Jarvis Landry. They also have Njoku when he was healthy. They had Kareem Hunt when he came back from his suspension. Dallas had who else? Is Ezekiel Elliott stealing touchdowns?
What was that?
Speedy's talking out of his you-know-what because that's what Speedy likes to do.
I know he is. I mean, he's talking craziness. So.
I don't think Amari Cooper is a top five wide receiver.
Well, that's what happens when someone plays with the you-know-what. So,
He does. He plays with a vibrator, yes.
Oh, my God. Enough of that. We're going with Schnozenator from now on.
No,
remember?
It's vibrator.
No,
that's
we're going
vibrator.
With Schnozenator from now on.
No, we're going with vibrator because that's what you're going to be selling on the streets. With your face on the tip of it. Yes, with his face on the tip of it.
Oh, well, you go have fun with that.
He's going to autograph it in stores near you. In all the Walmarts, he's going to be signing it.
I am not signing anything. I said I was merely selling them.
Up a sign on the street corner?
I'm not signing anything. I'm not encouraging them. I am giving the person the product and collecting money. That is merely it. That was merely the goal of all this.
I heard you were signing autographs.
Yes, because Errol likes to spread false rumors.
Oh, my God. All right, you guys. You have a good night.
All right, Ben.
All right, take care.
Oh, the beef. Speedy. Oh, Speedy is one interesting person, let me tell you. Anyways, 631-965-4990, 631-971-8070 is the numbers to call from now on. So you can call the show at two different numbers and talk to the very own special Speedy Dan Petey. Anyways, remember you can go to our website at worldwidesportsradio.com. You can follow us on all the social medias from Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, YouTube, radio.com, iHeartRadio, and TuneIn Radio. Just check us out on all the social media platforms if you miss any of our shows. Speedy, do you have anything to say before we go? Before you talk your buffoonity and your craziness of the vibration.
Yes. One last thing. Beef, sorry. Odell is better than Amari Cooper and better than Tyreek Hill. I'm sorry. That's it.
Who's better than Tyreek Hill?
Odell.
Odell is not better than Tyreek Hill.
That is what I'm ending with.
Well, and this is what I'm ending with you as being a psychopath and don't know what you're talking about. Statistics would show that Tyreek Hill in the last 3 years has been one of the top
three
receivers.
You put Tyreek Hill on the Giants, he's not even a top 10 receiver.
Really?
I'll tell you that right now.
Really?
Yeah.
I beg to differ on that. Why do you say that? That Tyreek Hill is one of the fastest, if not the fastest player on the field in all of professional football. So I don't know what you make Odell Beckham out to be bigger and better than what he is when he hasn't had a great, great season in the last 2 years. So stick it up your ass, Speedy.
And he wouldn't do that on the Giants in the Giants' circumstances.
Stick it up your ass, Speedy. Anyways, that's it for our show. We'll be back tomorrow. Me, Speedy Petey, talking sports here on Down to the Wire.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.